felt this way. Can't get enough, so stay with me. It's not like we got big plans. Let's drive around town holding hands. And I need to know you're the only one.
Sorry, baby. It's true.
I care about both of you. You can't do this.
We only have one choice. Who do you want to live
with? Can't we do like a 50-50?
No, sweetie. I'm moving to the normal world.
What?
Mac holding on my clothes. Mac warm when you get close to me. Slow dance these summer nights. Hard disco balls, my kitchen light. And you need to know that nobody can take your place. Your place. And you need to know.
I know you like Duke.
What? No.
He's always talking about you. I know he likes you.
Really?
Yeah, we should all go to the parties together.
Okay.
Oh, my heart is so good. I love you, yeah. So bad. So bad. Oh, my heart is so good. I love you, yeah. So bad. So bad.
Protagonist and pivot point is Addison Coleman, a junior in high school with blonde hair and blue eyes. She's the main character of the story and an overall great person who cares about everyone that is close to her. Her ability of divergence also allows her to be extremely conscientious because when given a choice, she can look into the future and see the two possible outcomes to contemplate every choice she faces in her life. I thought this was very interesting because I've never heard of this ability in a story or in a movie that deals with clairvoyance. This gives her a very predictable life, but it also makes her think of people differently. This is because when she does a search, she already feels like she has lived the outcome, even if she didn't actually live it. For example, she searches about going to a homecoming dance with a boy from school, and she finds out that he takes advantage of her, but even though he didn't, she looks at him as if he did. Away from her ability, she's an average teenager in the compound. She is also very dynamic, though. Throughout the story, all of the events change her beliefs and who she is. She starts out very naive and not knowing what she wants. And by the end, with everything that has happened, she is confident and knows how to get what she wants. This makes her and her best friend, Layla, very good dramatic foils. Layla is very beautiful and popular. Addie even says at times that if she and Layla had met now instead of as kids, she doesn't know if they would be best friends. Layla is very outgoing, fun, and spontaneous, which draws a stark contrast to Addie, who is very shy and sticks to what she knows, especially using her searches, and so she knows everything that will happen in her life. This especially comes out when they go to parties or when they talk to Duke, as Layla is always the one to call over Duke and start the conversation. The relationship reminds me of those basic teenage relationships like in Edge of 17, where the two best friends from childhood grow up to be one timid, Nadine, and one popular, Krista. Their relationship is also relatable to my own life with a friend of mine, which made it much easier to connect to these characters and make it feel like I was really a part of the story. Layla herself is a very stock, flat character playing the typical pretty and popular best friend, who is there to help just tell the story. Duke is more of a round character. He has many sides to him that you would never expect. These come out more and more if you read the book. Duke also reminds me of the typical popular boy who falls for the average girl, like in John Tucker Must Die or Hairspray. While Trevor is more an explicit character. He is very important to the story, of course, but his personality is very flatly laid out and there's nothing really to learn about him during the course of the story, and he stays pretty much the same personality-wise. He reminds me of PETA from The Hunger Games, being that they both have qualities that are very dependable, grounded, and insightful. Although her parents are very flat characters, they are of course important to the story because they're the reason for the entire search. Her father is loving, caring, and they share a close relationship, similar to Cinderella and her dad after her mother dies. Her mother is cold and distant. That's really all there is to those characters. There are two main settings in the story, both set in present day. The first is the compound, a secret world in Texas for those gifted with special abilities. The compound is hidden to all others and just looks like a plain old mountain range. I loved how they added that it was just a mountain range because it makes you wonder if this could be happening in real life among us. This is where Addie grew up and lives her whole life until her parents are getting a divorce. The setting is a very integral setting. They have very advanced technology. For example, when Addie goes to the normal world, she has no idea how to use a doorknob because there, all the doors are automatic. They just open by themselves. The compound also makes the characters living there very sheltered because they don't know how to act around the normal people and they don't even know anything about America's history, even though they technically live there. The other setting is Dallas, Texas, where she lives with her father in that part of the search. The specific setting of Dallas is more of a backdrop setting. Her father could have moved to any normal city and it would have been the same. They do really love football, which is a big aspect and a stereotype to Texas, but it could have been anywhere in the US. The normal world, of course, is an important setting because it's the reason for the whole story, but Dallas is not, because it could have been anywhere. Her father just lives in a small, typical apartment, and she just goes to a normal public school there. The setting in the normal world reminds me of Band Slam because of how they are really big into football and they're both in Texas and they just go to a normal high school. This also made me relate to the book more because it was a very relatable high school, like it could have been PSEP. Now to the plot elements of the story. The exposition of the story was very short and it doesn't take long to get into the actual bulk of the story. I love this because I hate slow book. It just portrays her life as an average, normal teenager. It then gets right into the divorce in the first chapter. The rising action is the bulk of the story, of course. She goes back and forth in each chapter between each boy and each possible future. During this time, you learn more about each boy and each life. This makes it feel like you're living both futures and you have to pick a side. The author does a great job of making you fall in love with both potential futures and both boys, with Trevor opening up to her and Duke taking her under his wing. I really love this about the book because much of it was seeing her fall in love, and I love those kind of books. In this story, I got to see it happen twice under different circumstances. The climax is, of course, when she decides which parent to live with. The conflict of the story could be looked at as either a problem she encounters in both futures with a different outcome based on which future she would pick, or the conflict could be looked at as more of a psychological battle between herself, within herself. The searches she is doing really affect who she is as a person because of how she views others. She was always fighting herself on what to do and changing her own fate. Pivot Point shows us an alternate world we could truly imagine living in with the research already going on today. This always makes a book more interesting because of the what-if factor. I can just imagine being an eraser who can erase people's memories like Layla, or a discerner like her father who can be who is basically a human lie detector. The gifted characters in the compound are gifted because they can access more of their brain. In the book, they talk about how normal humans can only access 20%. This is a common myth, but does hold some truth. Humans can use all of their brain, but they're only using some parts of it at certain times. The real research is trying to study how our brain can learn more. The human brain has amazing potential to learn, we just need to figure out how to teach it more. This can be found in articles such as, Do We Really Use 10% of Our Brain? At the Scientific American. Similar ideas are in many shows and movies and books. For example, if you love the movie Lucy, you would love this book. They both deal with non-specific special abilities given to those who can access more of their brain. Pivot Point just uses a teenage coming-of-age type story, and Lucy is more of an action thriller, but the same idea goes on. Overall, as shown by my examples, it is a great book for teenage love as a basic plot or undertone, but has a more deeper, complex meaning. The whole lovey-dovey aspect is why I really loved the book. It makes it very relatable, and the book also has sci-fi powers aspect to make it not so typical and overdone. Because how many times have we heard of the popular boy falls for the average girl, or the girl has to pick between the popular boy or the artsy boy? I mostly concentrated on the love story part of it, but it does have a bit of a mystery danger aspect to it. But I don't want to give away too much, so you just have to read it. So, if you love teenage love triangles with a scientific twist, you'd love Pivot Point by Casey West.